most beautiful place in the world, where a Tar Heel blue sky blankets Murphy on its way to the Tennessee border. It's a long way from Raleigh and the Outer Banks, but we're living in Carolina too. In fact, you might call it extreme Carolina. With more, here's Michael Borkman.
Welcome once again to Extreme Carolina, the show that features guests and topics related to Clay, Cherokee, and surrounding counties. Today, we're truly, truly blessed to have in the studio with us Miss Gina Connolly. She is the superintendent of Cherokee County School System, which is a big system in Western Carolina, from what I understand, one of the bigger ones. And so we're just so pleased and happy to have her in the studio with us today. Hello, Miss Gina.
Why, thank you, Michael. So glad to be here today.
Well, it is our pleasure to have you here, because I have been chasing you for a long time. We started this show like about 5 months ago, and I think a month in, I started trying to catch up with you. And our mutual friend, Mr. Stephen Aff,
yes,
he said, "Hey, man, that's the lady. You want to get her?" You know, he gave me three or four names, but yours was at the top. And of course, you're the last one that I finally catch up with from that list that he gave me. So thank you.
I'm a busy girl.
Yes, you are. Oh, my goodness, you're busy. And you are actually the superintendent over a county that has, from what I understand, 14 principals?
Yes, sir.
Wow. That's a lot of folks to keep up with.
It sure is.
And under those 14, that umbrella, from what I understand, is like maybe about 500 in terms of employees. But the student population is like 3,500?
Close to 3,500 on average, yes.
Wow. That's a lot of chirins, as they say.
It sure is. It's a lot of little souls every day.
Wow. Well, good. We know you do a good job. Well, let me jump into some of the questions that I have for you right away before we go down that road. Speaking of children and teaching, what was it that got you interested in becoming a teacher? Because at heart, that's what you are. You're a teacher, even though you're a superintendent, but at heart, you are a teacher. So what motivated you to want to be a teacher?
Well, actually, that's a very good question. Very early on, maybe second or third grade, I think I was cultivated to become a teacher by some very good teachers in the profession.
Really?
As a student, I found that I loved helping other students. I was one of those lucky little students that was told, could you go over two desks over and help,
and help
Johnny?
Yeah.
And maybe read, could you help so-and-so out with a word?
Wow.
And I loved doing that. And as my
early
grandfather
on.
Was a Baptist minister.
Okay.
Who felt very much that he was called to that profession, and I sort of kind of mirrored that in my own profession. I felt like this is something I was called to do.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Of course, in college, I entertained other ideas that I would go off and be a wealthy business person or an international kind of traveler, but I just was always brought back to the profession. That's where my heart was, yes.
Wow. Yeah, because I noticed that you said you went away and you came back. And you didn't just come back. You came back to the same town you left from.
It sure
did. It wasn't even a close town. It was the town.
Yes.
Wow. I've been to Andrews a couple of times, and it's beautiful over there. You got that long, what is that, that little strip, that straightaway
it
right through there?
The valley.
The valley.
It is the valley, the magic valley. That's what we call it.
It's beautiful over there. It really is. Now, also, you moved up in doing the teaching when you came back and you became a teacher. And now, part of that teaching, I noticed that you had in your bio a CTO. And for those of my listeners out there who don't know what that means, that's not a GTO, that's CTO. GTO is a car. But anyway, a chief technology officer.
Yes.
So you got the thing for technology. You really, really like that? Or is
I
that-
did. I refer to my career as kind of like the accidental administrator. I sort of fell into things as I became fascinated with them. And
okay.
Early on, I was an early adopter of technology. In my building, I was an English teacher, and my principal came to me to help him with setting up his email the first time it came around. And somehow I just became... got the label that I was the technology guru.
Wow.
And I followed that. as opportunities came forward for professional development, I became a learner and took it seriously.
So you actually are, you could do it. So you weren't faking it. You actually could do some of the stuff. You could set up some programs and some and the technology area.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Oh. I'm very proud. Cherokee County Schools has a powerful infrastructure. We were one of the first districts to lock into the fiber, mm-hmm. and we took a wheel and spoke technology system to mm-hmm. to full thread. We host our own servers. We do. I was very much the director of that and happy.
Wow.
Proud of that.
That is, I was going to, kind of the question I was going to lead into that. Matter of fact, let me reset it for all of our listeners. You're listening to Extreme Carolina today with Dr. Gina Conley. She is our guest today, and she is an amazing talent. Got some stuff that she's not really, we won't get into all of that, but part of the job she had was a CTO officer. Now, the question is this, how is it that technology, and you kind of brushed it just a minute ago, how is technology working out in the schools in terms of helping with educating the children?
I think particularly in a rural area, it's mm-hmm. sort of leveled the playing field. Our students used to suffer from isolation. We were 2.5-3 hours away from a museum, 2.5-3 hours away from a city. Right. And now technology has bridged that gap for us. So our students are as accustomed through by means of technology of seeing everything that other students who get to grow up in mm-hmm. the more municipal places
right.
have. So that's been powerful. It also assists students who have had learning disabilities.
Mm-hmm.
We find that through technology, they're much easier to reach, and they're able to communicate better and able to help others understand them, and we're able to translate information in a way that they can process and understand.
Wow. So you come a long way from the teacher having to say, Gina, would you go over there and help John? And yes. so that he can pay attention.
And beat the erasers on the side of the schoolhouse wall. Yes.
Right. Yeah. Long way from that.
Yeah.
So the technology is, so now, so is iPads in every room or not? Or
in Cherokee County Schools, we are one-to-one technology in most, all through middle and high school.
Okay.
In most of our elementary schools, our fifth mm-hmm. grade is one-to-one. Our weapon of choice is the Chromebook. But with the younger students, we do have an influx of iPads.
Okay.
Max. And we like to say that we are two students to one device. We're two to one at that level.
Okay.
They share.
Yeah, because 3,500 is a lot. I mean, it would take a lot of support financially to kind of get one in every student's hand.
It really does. It really does. Even being fifth grade through grade 12, one-to-one with a Chromebook, and we're very proud of our Chromebook initiative in Cherokee County Schools.
Okay.
When our students graduate
mm-hmm.
from high school, they take their device with them.
Wow, so it's theirs forever.
It's theirs forever.
Wow, well, it's probably like outdated at that point.
Well, we don't brag about that, but we are happy that they've earned it.
Right, yeah.
They've earned it. Sometimes the lack of a device is an obstacle for students going to college.
Really?
And we don't want that to be a problem.
Want to be a barrier, a burden, to not have at least some piece that you bring into the next level with you. That is awesome. Which kind of leads me to one of the other questions, that with this advent of next level technology, mm-hmm. are we seeing more students graduating now, or are we like still on the same level? Has it helped in terms of that?
It has definitely helped in North Carolina, and specifically in Cherokee County. We have consistently over the last 5 years been one of the top districts in the state for graduation rate. Our graduation rate is a 94%.
Wow.
Which is very impressive. And some of our schools mm-hmm. are even at a 96% graduation rate. So we are definitely seeing more students succeed and achieve that diploma.
That is amazing. Well, I tell you what, we're getting ready, Dr. Conley, to come up on the break. Well, we have to give our sponsors an opportunity to jump in there and do what they do, and which is cool. I mean, because lights got to be, bills got to be paid. So we let them jump in. We'll step aside right here, but we'll be right back with Dr. Gina Conley, and we'll continue our conversation with her. Don't go away.
Tar Heel basketball, Cam's Panthers, Asheville's eclectic nightlife, and the Great Smoky Mountains. It belongs to us too, out here in Extreme Carolina. Once again, here's Michael Borkman.
Welcome back, everybody. Welcome back to Extreme Carolina. Today, we're here with Dr. Gina Conley.
Hello.
And we have been having just a blast of information, of imparting to me information about what she does. She is in charge of, or she is the current superintendent of Cherokee County Schools since December 2014.
That's right.
So just past 2 years.
Yes.
And on the job. And you still got most of your hair, so
I do. I know they can't see that, but I do. So.
Well, I can see it, y'all, and it's beautiful hair too.
Thank you.
But anyway, so it's a tough job.
Yes,
trying to run that's running a big corporation, pretty much.
It is. We're $38 million organization.
Wow, that's a lot of cheddar, as the young folks say today. Well, in doing that, you have that's a lot of children from a lot of diverse background that's in your school system. Because in people who don't know this, Cherokee County, if you look at the map, it is western, extreme western North Carolina, which the name of the show, Extreme Carolina,
that's right.
falls right hand in hand with each other. So you get from the southern and westernmost tip of North Carolina.
Yes.
And back in a little bit. So you've got a lot of diverse and what was it, topical that you called it a minute ago?
A lot of different topography in the winter. Sometimes we have to call school off and people in Murphy go, why are we calling school off? And they don't understand that there's 2 inches of snow in Wolf Creek or on Red Marble. It's too dangerous for kids to travel.
Exactly. So. And the most important thing is the safety of our children.
Amen.
You know, getting them back and forth to work because you got all these buses and these things, they can slip and slide easily.
Absolutely.
You know, on these roads. Yeah, on a good day.
Yes.
And that's with the sun shining. So we don't want any accidents. So, but with that, now you said there's diverse topography. You know, that word is just having a hard time saying that. But anyway, the ranges.
Yes.
You got valleys and hills. Okay.
We do.
And but with that comes children of various degrees in terms of economics.
Yes.
And so there's your school has been, I wouldn't say labeled, but it's a fact. That the statistics support that you have over 75% below the poverty line?
We do, based on free and reduced lunch calculations.
Wow.
We do have 75% of our students at the very least. And some of our schools, a couple of them hit 90% of students below free and reduced lunch rate.
That is amazing. Now, but that is good that we're able to provide the food for these folks. School lunch is critical because, I mean, you can't concentrate if you're hungry.
You Absolutely. Know? And in fact, we qualify for the community enrichment program, which means the state of North Carolina gives free breakfast to every student in Cherokee County, pre-K through grade 12.
Wow.
And every student grades pre-K through grade 8 receives free lunch. So take that into account that the state has said it's cheaper for us to give you all this free food than it is to process paperwork.
Okay.
That's a very powerful statement.
That is a huge statement.
USDA.
Wow. To give, then to do the paperwork, we'll just give you the food.
That's right.
Which actually is better anyway.
I mean,
they rather have the food. I mean, you know, who wants to sit around doing paperwork when we got our stomach is making noises and stuff?
It's been a tremendous help as far as the red tape is concerned and being able to offer this to all of our students. We think it makes a real difference in the communities. We also send home about 500 extra food bags a week with different students from the Manna Food Bank and local churches to make sure that students have that supplement through the weekend.
Through the weekend, yes. Right. So now what's the name of that program?
It's the Backpack Program.
Backpack,
and
okay.
Different churches call it different things.
Yes.
But Manna provides the foundation for it, and then local churches supplement that.
Wow. Yeah, I know we do that. The church that I go to, we support. Every month there's a different item that we send to the food bank. And so it's amazing. I love participating in that. For everyone, we want to reset again. We're here with Dr. Gina Connolly on Extreme Carolina today. She's the school superintendent of Cherokee County, does an amazing job. And we've been talking about the kids that she is over, as well as adults. But now, if there was, what would you say the toughest part of your job has been since you took the mantle of superintendent?
I think the toughest part is overcoming just sort of what we were talking about a moment ago with the poverty level. My mom has a saying that we didn't know we were poor until somebody told us we were.
Amen.
And we, to make certain that everyone who works and teaches for us maintains those high expectations,
mm-hmm.
because your poverty level, while it's very relevant to the conditions that you're living in and what you're going through,
mm-hmm.
And everything affects your learning, students still have the ability to learn at the same rate no matter what their poverty level. And sometimes
wow.
students in a lower poverty level need higher expectations. We have to do it better and we have to do it harder than everybody else.
Wow.
So I think that to establish those high expectations, mm-hmm. and to shun away that old the idea that we should feel sorry for kids,
mm-hmm.
or they can't help it, they can't
right.
feel better. Absolutely not.
Absolutely
they,
not.
They can perform, and we expect them to perform.
And they can perform at high, high levels,
absolutely.
Too.
Absolutely.
Fantastic. Which brings me to my next question. I want to shift gears here just a little
sure.
bit. Speaking of learning, what book have you, the superintendent, head teacher, what book have you read recently that had the biggest impact on you and why?
I read all the time. I'm an English teacher by nature, so and I've recently been reading The Secret History of Wonder Woman, which is a fantastic book if anybody out there wants to read it. But
okay.
the book that I believe impacted my learning the most, besides the Bible, would probably have been Malcolm Gladwell's The Tipping Point.
Yes.
It's about how good things can spread just as quickly as something negative like a virus. Whenever
wow.
you trigger the right people,
mm-hmm.
and create the right conditions for mm-hmm. good things to happen.
Wow. That is amazing. It's a good book. I've actually read that one, and you're spot on that. And I am somewhat of a reader myself. I love to read. And it didn't happen until later in life, by the way. I hated school when I was in school. But now that I'm an adult and don't have to go to school, I can't put a book down. I love books. I got one every day, every evening. But anyways, so that's great. Now, let me ask you this. You've been doing a lot of different things. So, Dr. Gina Connolly,
mm-hmm.
what has been the best advice you've ever received?
A lot of great advice. Some of it unsolicited has been given to me many times, and I get a lot every week. But I did have a professor
mm-hmm.
at Western Carolina who told me who we were reading a lot about leadership, and the best
right.
advice came from a quote from Warren Bennis that he quoted, was that managers do things right, but leaders do the right thing.
Awesome.
And his advice was to know which you needed to be at the right time.
Sometimes you do
need a good manager. If you come into an organization that is amiss, things are not in place, you have to spend some time building that organization and putting things
yep.
in the right pockets. But also there comes a time when you just need to do the right thing.
Do
and
the
step
right
up.
Thing.
And that's
step
the difference
up.
Between a leader and a manager. And that's been very important to me.
Well, you are a leader. Ain't no doubt about that. But I want to get in one last good question, because to me this is really, really important. And we may have even touched on it before. But now, what do you believe that is impossible to do in your field, but if it could be done, would fundamentally just change the industry?
I believe if teachers were able to have the resources in hand, again, to take care of the whole child. Lots of times teachers teach their subject,
mm-hmm.
and some of them teach the child, but we are seeing so many broken spirits come
mm-hmm.
to us
wow.
sitting in the classroom, and so many times that just the reading, the writing, and the arithmetic, we're feeding their need for knowledge, but we're not feeding their need for spirit. And
awesome.
There's certain boundaries that you can't cross there, and certain times we just don't have the skill set to do that. But if we had the resources to be able to guide students into fixing themselves and helping making themselves whole through emotional, social, mental health, mm-hmm. I believe that that's where we could cross the boundary.
Awesome. Wow. Well, I could think of at least five other questions that I could ask just on that one right there, but I'm afraid we've kind of run up against the clock, and we have to have you back. I mean, sure. We definitely have to get you back.
But, I love an audience.
Well, I tell you what, I'm going to have to cut it off right here, but before we do, Extreme Carolina is committed to you, our listeners, to bring you leaders, newsmakers that are passionate and purpose-driven, like Dr. Jim here, and making a difference by listening to their stories. Extreme Carolina listeners will have an opportunity to refuel, reconnect, and get inspired by unlocking the power of the people. Here it is, quote of the week, drum roll. That was a drum roll. Quote of the week, there are risk and costs to a plan of action, but there are far less than the long-range risk and cost of comfortable inaction. Hey, y'all, thanks for being with us. See you. Have a great, prosperous week, and we'll see you next time. God bless. Love you.
Staring up the road and pray to God I see headlights. I made it down the coast in 17 hours, picking me a bouquet of dogwood flowers, and I'm hoping for Raleigh, I can see my baby tonight.